I think went a little further than that down the next paragraph.
Okay, yeah. But Julia had become adept at rationalizations. Accommodating her husband did not finally seem that far removed from the myriad daily concessions she made. The notion of what it would mean to be a mother was slowly overtaken by what it meant to Mother Martha, just as her idea of a husband gave way to the reality of her husband. Was she angry or jealous, insulted or relieved? Had his indiscretions been at her expense, or had they somehow become her strength? She knew that whatever love was, it was also the opposite. Her love for her daughter proved that. She reminded herself of what she sometimes forgot due to the challenges of raising Martha and the recognition of how small her life had become, that her daughter was all the best words there were, words that people who grew up to become adults seem to forget. Martha was joy, she was delight, she was glee.
Thank you. Within that story, and truly in those three different parts, it is interesting how you have, I mean, that could have been a book in itself, those three sections. But the last one where the father now is no longer with Julia, mm-hmm. he's taking the daughter and her son to the lake they always went to. And there is a moment where the daughter, who is retarded or mentally problems, is going to almost drown. And he goes out to save her, and it's a tide.
Riptide
that's pulling them off. But it is her son, 8-year-old, on the shore saying, "Mother," and you get goosebumps as you read it, because you can almost see inside the grandfather's mind, life would be easier.
Right. Well, I think that that's sort of the devastating thing at the end of the story, is that he's a man who coped with this really difficult situation of raising his daughter by distancing himself. And by being sort of halfway there, loving her, yeah. But being sort of halfway available to his wife and to his daughter. And I think at the end of the story, you see that he wants to have a relationship with the grandson that maybe fills in some of the gaps that he didn't have with his daughter. But he also realizes that he can't, because the primal relationship is between the grandson and his mother, between Martha and Gary, the little boy. And he is sort of ultimately left out in the cold.
Yeah, or it's a lady of the tiger there, because he could have stayed back and she would have gone. He could help her and almost drown himself. It's, what is he going to do?
Right. Yeah. And it's that action, you know, action is such a great way of trying to explore character. It sort of brings into absolute focus what his dilemma is.
And Julia, just in one line, you have said she was a legal, the type of attorney she was, gave it all up when her daughter's born. And then it's as if that another life never existed.
Right.
What was the catalyst for that book, for that
story? For that story? Wow, that's a great question. You know, I never can remember what sets me to writing a story. I sit down and something just comes. And the story comes. I mean, I can tell you where certain things come from, you know, but there was no moment where I sat down and said, I'm going to write a story about a couple who has a mentally challenged daughter who's pregnant. It just sort of comes as I sit down. I think I had an image of this young pregnant girl in a baby pool, and that was where I started.
Mm-hmm. Children shouldn't have children. Yeah.
You know, those are judgment calls I'm not going to make. I think that it's, you know, what I really try to do in the stories is not judge the characters and not lay kind of black and white judgment on them, but just sort of see where they're coming from, what their motivations are, what drives them. I think that, you know, there are very few sort of evil people in the world. There's people who make decisions that we might not agree with, but they make them because they're driven by some very genuine passion and desire. And I think as a short story writer, that's what I care about exploring.
Daughter-mother relationship is very strong in this book, especially in Night Train to Frankfurt.
Yeah. That's a story about a woman who takes her older and quite ill mother on a train from Munich to Frankfurt to go to some very esoteric place to try to cure her mother's cancer. And her mother's chosen to do this, and it's obviously sort of a half-hearted bid at survival. And it's very uncharacteristic for her mother to choose this very kind of goofy place to go. But it's really a story about each of them coming to terms with a really interesting, naughty, complicated love at the moment that it's about to disappear.
And the daughter had been a pianist, mm-hmm. and then had realized she didn't have what it takes to be great. So she becomes something called a page turner.
Well, yeah, that's one of her many music-related jobs. I don't think you could make a whole career being a page turner, but yeah. I've sat in the symphony many times and thought about the person who's turning the page, so I wanted to...
And especially, you have, again, the writer as an artist. She is turning the page for a young woman who, in a way, is what she would have liked to have been. Mm-hmm. And the girl freezes, the pianist freezes, and she has to decide, do I get further? Do I help? How she works out that frozen pianist moment.
Right. Which is a parallel in the story to her helping her mother, and to what degree does she insert herself in her mother's illness and her mother's decisions. And I think that's why those two things occurred to me at the same time. I think they all have to do with sort of where are the lines of responsibility and how do we care for the people who we care for.
And even the way you have her on that rocking train from Munich to Frankfurt, when the mother has to go to the bathroom, and it is that pride, mm-hmm. that physical pride that no one should see me in a way naked to the world.
I think that that's one of the things that people who are quite ill, really, it's hard. You have to be let go of a lot of your inhibitions, and it must be, it's a very, you know, I'm sure humiliating experience to have to, you know, let people help you in ways that have been, that are embarrassing. And I think, again, it's this incredible moment for a mother and a daughter who you know, it's a reversal. I think many people experience that. But the mother still has her pride, and she still won't let the daughter into the bathroom with her. And she, you know, she prefers to practically fall rather than to let her daughter do it. So it's a real, you know, during the story you see this, not so much a power play, but shift of dynamic between how much each one is able to help the other.
Again, I would say, where's the catalyst for this book? But you obviously have seen enough that somewhere you sort of harbored the thought.
Yeah. I mean, I certainly, this one came from an experience a friend of mine was having with her mother, although it didn't happen. You know, this whole trip to Germany didn't happen. But most of my ideas start with, you know, very tiny little moments or tiny ideas of a character or a line of dialogue or an image. And then somehow my subconscious takes over and a story unfolds.
The other that's very, is in the hospital, El Lobo.
Mm-hmm. That's in the story, The Visitor, yeah.
Yeah, and the ghost, the mother who's seeing a ghost who has lived through hell with her own daughter, and the child who would say to the grandma, let my mother in. And the mother was a druggie that the grandmother didn't want allowed in.
Right. It's a story, and the daughter now is a young woman, and she's working at a Veterans Administration hospital and taking care of a man who she calls El Lobo, who's quite horrifically wounded. And I think that there's a lot of ghosts running around those stories. There's the ghost that her grandmother sees, and there's the ghost that her own mother had become, and the ghost that this young boy has become with his body so maimed. And also, I think that the ghost that she is in a certain way, because I think that when children are denied a certain kind of parenting, they are ghostly in a certain way.
Pursue that a little further.
I think that it's hard to feel that you deserve your life when you haven't been given a certain kind of love. I think that it makes it hard to, I mean, this is a generalization, I'm sure it's not true for many, many people, but I think that when you have been denied a kind of primal care by a mother, I think that you feel not quite there.
Yeah.
And I think that's why she identifies with this young soldier in the hospital, is because they're both in some ways ghostly.
The last story is, the title of the book.
Yeah, Alone With You, yeah.